This episode of It's the End of the World as We Know It and I Feel Fine was made possible by contributions from slaves like you. Thank you very much.
The liberals were outraged by Trump, but they expressed their anger in cyberspace, so it had no effect. Because the algorithms made sure that they only spoke to people who already agreed with them. Instead, ironically, their waves of angry messages and tweets benefited the large corporations who ran the social media platforms. One online analyst put it simply, angry people click more. It meant that the radical fury that came like waves across the internet no longer had the power to change the world. Instead, it was becoming a fuel that was feeding the new systems of power and making them ever more powerful.
It's the end of the world as we know it. I feel fine.
Good morning, slaves, and welcome to another edition of It's the End of the World as We Know It, and I Feel Fine, the show where we wash down tacos with liberal tears.
I'm hungry. Let's get a taco.
Donald Trump will be the 45th president of the United States, winning the most unreal, surreal election we have ever seen. This candidacy starting on an escalator ride 1 year ago.
I am your host, the Stimulator, and after being held hostage for a year and a fucking half to the torturous political freak show that is the U.S. election,
it was horrible.
On Tuesday, November 9th, peeps around the world watching stunned horror as pundits and news anchors announced that a fascist fucking reality TV star had been selected for the most powerful motherfucking position on Earth.
This can't be happening, man. This isn't happening.
While world leaders like Vladimir Putin, Kim Jong-un, and the Philippine psychopathic jefe Rodrigo Duterte are fucking stoked to have an unstable, feckless megalomaniac with no political or military experience in the White House, politicians in Europe, on the other hand, are freaking the fuck out.
We've actually elected an internet troll as our president.
This sentiment was summed up by France's ambassador to the United States, Gerardo Rod, who, with the notable flair for the dramatic that the French are known for, claimed that Trump's election signaled the end of the neoliberal era and that, quote, the world is collapsing before our eyes.
U.S. Border Protection, how can I help you?
Pues sí, you can help me. Devuélveme mi trabajo.
And while a not-so-controlled demolition of the global political and economic order sounds like it'd be fucking great news, it's far-right nationalist parties who are the ones doing the celebrating.
Fuck Trump!
Fuck Trump!
Meanwhile, in the United States, shit starting popping off almost immediately. As votes were still being tallied, peeps in Portland, Eugene, and Oakland took to the streets to vent their rage. This was followed the next morning by mass high school walkouts in California, Colorado, New York, and D.C. And despite desperate appeals for peeps to unite around Trump, coming from the man your mama calls Obama, by Wednesday evening, a wave of spontaneous protests had broken out in cities all across the motherfucking country. These rowdy protests continued to swell and deepen over the next following nights, with tactics honed through the past 2 years of anti-police demos being put into effect. Highways were blocked, barricades went up, and rebellious youth threw down with the pigs.
I watched a white riot in Portland, Oregon on television the other night. News said they did $1 million worth of damage. Every black person was watching that like amateurs.
And to be sure, Trump and his supporters have given peeps plenty of reasons to throw down. In the days following his election, black and brown peeps, women, and anyone perceived as being Muslim have been hounded and attacked on the streets and in classrooms across the United States. In an open and hideously proud display of racism, even worse than the Brexit times five that Trump promised. And while most peeps are focused on the odious fucking personality of Trump himself, the implications of his presidency and who he's likely to elevate into position of power make shit even fucking worse.
I'm animated. I'm alive. My heart's big. It's got hot blood going through it fast.
Because let's be real, Trump's a fucking dipshit who doesn't know what the fuck he's doing.
They're remaking Indiana Jones without Harrison Ford. You can't do that. And now they're making Ghostbusters with only women. What's going on?
But he's surrounded by some seriously fucking dangerous pieces of shit. And with the Republicans consolidating control of both the House and the Senate, these dangerous turd-tokers are going to have a shit ton of leeway when it comes to implementing their hyper-repressive corporatist agenda. From his Vice President Mike Pence, a hawkish, homophobic, born-again Christian, Koch brothers frontman, climate change denier, and darling of the Tea Party, who will be the real power behind the throne, to Rudolph 9/11 Giuliani, who sits poised to be the next Attorney General, a man who, as mayor of New York, was instrumental in introducing stop and frisk and broken window policing,
and who has repeatedly gone on the record calling Black Lives Matter protesters racist.
Why do we have to say that Black Lives Matter? Now, I admit that is not the best slogan, but McDonald's already took "You Deserve a Break" today.
White nationalists, vigilante militias, and neo-Nazi groups will now feel even more emboldened to use paramilitary violence against their racial and political opponents. Immigrants will be rounded up and deported at even higher rates than before. And the pigs will be given a free hand to shoot and repress whoever the fuck they want without having to worry about having their feelings hurt by being gently chided by the president. In other words, shit's about to go from really bad to even motherfucking worse. The thin veneer of liberal respectability that hid the brutality of the Obama administration will be ripped off, once again revealing in all its hideous clarity the unrestrained white supremacist, heteropatriarchal, colonial violence that lies at the heart of American society. So, the question to the motherfucking resistance is, what the fuck are we gonna do about it?
Yeah, fuck ain't nobody Donald Trump. Else gonna speak up, yeah, we gonna speak
fuck
up.
Fuck Donald Trump. Yeah, nigga, fuck Donald Trump. Yeah, yeah, fuck Donald Trump.
I got a question. How'd he make it this far? How the fuck did it begin? A Trump rally sounds like Hitler in Berlin or KKK shit. Now I'm going in, I'm just saying what's real. Don't give a fuck who I've been, cause it's gotta be said. It's gotta be said. It's off the top like the toupee on Donald Trump's head. This man's not peaceful, racism's evil. This man hates Muslims, that's a billion fucking people. If truth be told, Donald is a terrorist. Reasons why the world's got a problem with Americans. The fuck is going on? People just passed, a mass murder happened. You said thanks for the congrats. Try and get your votes up, you don't got class. Orlando was a tragedy, you react fast. And it made about you, to boost your campaign. It's going all bad if he wins this damn thing.
In the wake of Trump's election, liberals and so-called progressives have been freaking the fuck out.
What do you mean he won?
Oh my god, we're gonna die!
Why didn't Hillary try harder, dude? Why would she fuck up with the emails, man?
She deserves to be the first female president. And that's what makes me so sad.
There's got to be a pony in this crap pile.
As the cold realization of his imminent victory started to sink in on election night,
I'm gonna grab a Xanax from the bedroom.
Okay, will you grab me six?
Yeah, I'm just gonna bring the whole bottle.
Many of these peeps started scrambling for the escape pods.
I've gotta get out of here.
In their unbridled haste to run away from the looming fight on their doorsteps, tens of thousands of Americans flooded the website of Immigration Canada. So many that they fucking crash its servers.
Opposing Donald Trump doesn't really make you a political refugee.
It makes you a Twitter user.
The day after the election, a crowd at Cornell University gathered together for a so-called cry-in, while volunteers handed out Play-Doh, tissues, coloring books, and hot chocolate to a mass of people who were so stunned by the shattering of their social media-induced blinders that they literally fucking regress into childhood. Now, I can completely understand that millions of peeps are feeling scared, nervous, and upset, but if I can be real with y'all, this shit is some of the most pathetic and spectacularly self-indulging acts of collective fucking cowardice I've seen in my fucking life. Let's sincerely hope that this is a temporary phenomenon and that these peeps can get their shit together and start to deal with the challenging and urgent task at hand.
Get it all together and put it in a backpack. All your shit, so it's together.
Because despite what people might want to believe, this isn't a nightmare. It's real fucking life.
This is us. This is our country. It's real.
Those Democrats weren't attempting to flee the fucking coup or reduced to a quivering display of public sobbing were busy angrily pointing fingers at whoever didn't line up behind their own corrupt millionaire war criminal candidate of choice.
I think you're the cause of all this. I think you're evil! Evil!
From the poor, non-college educated Trump voters that they looked down on as irredeemable and irrelevant white trash.
I just think you're dumb, okay? I think you're fucking dumb.
To so-called Bernie bros.
Why couldn't I have attracted young female fans?
To peeps who voted for third-party candidates, or those who, given the choice between two horrible options, decided not to vote at all. Anyone they could cast their blame at, in order not to have to take a long, hard look in the fucking mirror.
Fuck me, fuck you.
Because at the end of the fucking day, the liberal defenders of the status quo bear much of the blame for the state of affairs that created the movement that catapulted Trump and his corporatist cabal into power. From the DNC's Machiavellian media manipulation in support of Trump during the Republican primaries, to their inevitable shafting of Bernie Sanders and the resulting disillusionment of his base of idealistic young voters.
You're being ridiculous.
The extreme arrogance of Hillary Clinton and her supporters and the well-oiled machine of the Democratic Party came back to fucking bite them, and all of us, in the ass.
Got bit in the ass today, son.
I told you.
You ain't telling me shit.
It should come as no surprise that many of the smug, condescending liberals who are always telling anarchists and other radicals that using violence against Nazis makes us as bad as them are now taking Hillary's lead and tearfully accepting that there's nothing to do now but line up behind Trump and wait 4 years until peeps are giving another kick at the electoral can, because that's how democracy works. Well,
fuck you.
And fuck your bullshit democracy. From the Ferguson uprising to the courageous and ongoing land defenders at Standing Rock and every riot, blockade, protest in between, the motherfucking resistance has been fighting against the state and its oppressive security apparatus under Obama, and this resistance must now continue and intensify under President Trump. As white liberals are crying and soul-searching about how this could possibly happen to them, racialized peeps are being hunted and harassed in the streets by emboldened racists, drunk on their fascist champions' victory. The time is long past due for people to start getting serious about how to defend our communities from the onslaught of repression, because it's coming whether we're ready or not.
We're some real pretty shit now, man!
You finished.
So, on that cheery note, and in order to make a little more sense of just what the fuck's going down and what peeps can do about it, I recently caught up with Connor and Beth, two members of Redneck Revolt. Hey y'all, how the fuck are you?
Really, just about as good as we were last week.
As good as it can be in the end times, right?
In the immediate aftermath of the recent election, we've heard a lot of talk about how the United Snakes has become a deeply divided nation. Is this something new, or has this always been the case, and people just didn't notice?
Well, I think it's obvious that the country's always been divided into the rich and everyone else. Our part in that discussion is to draw attention to the historical divide between workers of color and the white working class. The majority of white working folks have been recuperated into being foot soldiers for landlords, bosses, the state, thinking that that will buy them access into white supremacy as a system that benefits them, when in reality, a lot of white workers and their family end up being poor because they have aided the enemy, the rich, in keeping power. The working class has been divided by, you know, turning their justifiable class rage against migrants and workers of color instead of against the rich. I also think that American capitalism is so deeply embedded in the bootstraps mentality that it's almost like a religion. Not only has that mindset kept white working class folks from blaming the state for their struggle, but it has been really effective at creating an aspirational identification with the middle class and to some extent even the upper class. And it's much easier to divide an oppressed working class from solidarity with their neighbors when you create this culture that looks down on their struggle and really makes them believe that they can do better if they just work harder.
There's also been a lot of finger pointing going on lately, with many leftist liberals and so-called progressives pinning much of the blame for how the election went down on the supposedly backward nature of uneducated white working class voters. Why do you think these peeps were so shocked by the scale of support for Trump, and what does that say about the current state of the left?
So obviously the white working class isn't backwards. The major issue is that they've been completely abandoned to the right, and the right has been able to recuperate them by offering easy answers to very complex problems and speaking directly to the conditions that most working class folks are facing every day. And the left has failed to do that. It's also been a huge problem where the people of power in the left, like the politicians, but also the leaders of a lot of social movements, come from the affluent classes of white folks. And so they don't have anything in common with the white working class. They treat the white working class as though they are this separate population that they need to study and understand and speak to in a different language, rather than actually trying to meet them on the ground where they're at. And so why would they be so surprised that they completely alienated that demographic? The problem with liberals across the board is that they weigh too heavily on this idea that they were the party or the group that wasn't doing any evil. But at some point, folks are going to demand receipts for all the alleged good they were doing, and there just isn't much to show for it.
The Trump campaign served as a clarion call for a loose coalition of neo-Nazis and other white reactionaries, many of whom have coalesced under the umbrella of the so-called alt-right. What do you make of this movement, and how do you expect things to play out now that their candidate has been elected?
Well, I fully expect there's going to be resistance to Trump, just like there was to Obama and the Tea Party movement. I think if the resistance is successful, even in a minor way, which it very well could be, there's a good chance that these folks of the alt-right will mobilize to defend, you know, everything that they hope could have happened under a Trump presidency. Following his win, you know, we've heard talk of Trump adding far-right economic conservatives to his cabinet and transition team. So, like, this makes it clear to that as time progresses and Trump's policies have a chance to play out, that they're going to negatively impact working and poor people's lives. Obviously, we've known this, but this is going to cause fissures to open up among his supporters. And our network intends to be active in exploiting these splits and to be ready to work with newly disillusioned people who found hope in Trump's campaign at one time.
How the fuck did a billionaire real estate tycoon like the Donald manage to pull off playing the role of the anti-establishment candidate?
Because the institutional left, and especially our social justice movements, have really entrenched this idea of, like, everything you're doing is wrong, and how could you not already know that? I think folks are just genuinely relieved to have somebody that they saw as a potential leader who didn't approach things that way or talk to them that way. He also came out really strongly against neoliberal capitalist models like NAFTA, and folks recognize that they are feeling the daily effects of those jobs, you know, being outsourced. And so having somebody speak directly to those realities and talking sort of like them goes a long way. The other thing, though, is that there's just a general mentality around wanting change. You know, the people on the left are just as easily fooled and recuperated into a change candidate. We watch them do the same thing with Obama, we watch them do the same thing with Bernie, and so this tendency to look at everything that the folks on the right do as not recognizable within our own structures is part of what is making that conversation so difficult.
Over the past several years, the United Snakes has witnessed a dramatic rise in reactionary white paramilitary violence. Can you speak to the role that this type of violence plays in terms of maintaining white supremacy and reinforcing the domination of the state and capitalism?
Historically, when populations of folks have lost a lot of access to resources, you know, call it privilege, whatever, there has been this shift to blame. In this case, we're talking about the loss of jobs, homes, you know, opportunities for advancement, long-term security, food, you know, these are all really vital things that have been slowly slipping away, and people are looking for somebody to blame. And since very few of the, you know, the elements on our side of the barricade are actively trying to organize folks to target their actual enemies, and the right wing is heavily focused on that, they continue to play the foot soldiers of white supremacy and divide the working class. They keep the struggle and the violence contained within the working class, which again reinstitutes the power of the state overall. It benefits the neoliberals as well. We also need to take a really hard look at the way that the institutional left has, again, driven the conversation about the resistance of folks of color and all the uprisings that we've seen over the last several years into these very useless academic hand-wringing conversations about white guilt and privilege. White folks recognizing that they have a stake in the fight against white supremacy itself is incredibly important, as well as addressing the obligation that we have to use our access to white spaces and our complicity in white supremacy to actively work against it. But we are much more effective working against it when we're not being hampered by white guilt and liberal ally politics.
What strategies should revolutionaries in the United Snakes be undertaking to address this recent surge in racially motivated attacks?
White anti-racists and revolutionaries need to be digging in for a long fight with for the hearts and souls of our neighbors, family members, friends, and community members. We need to be taking over and making space for anti-racist education from a working class perspective. In the cultural spaces already dominated by the white working class, anywhere people use as spaces of convergence, gun shows, concerts, swap meets, bowling alleys, barbecues, baseball games, places where our families and friends frequent. We need to be actually organizing our communities against white supremacy and capitalism. At the same time, we got to be able to defend our neighborhoods, communities, and collaborate with others to build strong movements of resistance. We advocate for coalitions of community defense initiatives that work to build armed and unarmed defense of marginalized communities, including white working class communities, from reactionary attacks at both the street and systemic levels. As long as our enemies are heavily armed, we need to be knowledgeable of how to fight that threat without resorting to oppressive state powers. We also have to insert ourselves directly into the areas where militant reactionaries radicalize and recruit. We have to meet people where they're at, you know? Otherwise, we're always going to have a steady flow of people ready to plan these attacks. This is our dual strategy that we offer at Redneck Revolt. Organize and prepare to defend.
Can you tell us a bit about your group, Redneck Revolt, and your affiliate project, the John Brown Gun Club?
So Redneck Revolt is a national umbrella which attempts to offer resources, direction, and organization to individuals and branches across the country. And we're encouraging individuals interested in forming a branch to contact us, find out if a branch has already been formed, or find out how to form one of their own. Branches will engage in activities ranging from outreach with historical, political, economic, and social analysis, networking with other groups, marginalized folks, leftists, and anti-capitalists, and anti-racist, to basic firearm acquaintance and safety, community defense, legal assistance, and more. A number of chapters have already formed, and interest is growing by the day. We've gotten, especially since the election, we've just gotten dozens of emails and messages on our Facebook page about, you know, do you have a chapter here? I want to start a chapter here. Several chapters have chosen to stick with the name Redneck Revolt, and then, like Phoenix, for example, has chosen to call their branch the John Brown Gun Club, of course in reference to the legacy of John Brown, but also referencing a similar project undertaken years ago right here in Lawrence that became the inspiration for Redneck Revolt.
Thanks, y'all. And that about does it for this edition of It's the End of the World as We Know It, and I Feel Fine. In case you didn't know, peeps are planning a massive mobilization to unwelcome Donald Trump on January 20th in Washington, D.C. To get the deets, visit disruptj20.org. Next month will mark the 10th anniversary of this fucking show. Can you believe that shit? We have a very special show planned and due to drop on December 12th. So mark your fucking calendars, call your peeps, and get your popcorn ready. As always, this show is independently funded, and that has allowed us to run our mouth against Bush, Obama, and now this orange face anomaly. This month, the fallen wage slaves dropped some Trump dollars into our tip jar. So many motherfucking thanks to Olivier, Clara, Sawyer, Kaylee, Jason, Renko, Jacob, Massage, Brian, Daniel, Matthew, Anthony, Jennifer, Francois, Shannon, Steven, Jonathan, Max, Margaret, Martin, Derek, Mexa, Sam, Jania, Gregory, Luigi, John, Matt, Maya, Liam, Jorge, Luis, Louis, Sebastian, Yifan, Rinzo, Christopher, Lara, Tom, Scott, Jeremy, Jonathan, Jacob, Gavin, Wolfgang, Ryan, Benjamin, Kate, Justina, Veronica, Johnny, Kirk, Zav, Marisol, Joseph, Sawyer, Philip, Steven, Kobe, Sebastian, Giuliano, Brett, Volkov, Carlo, Philip, Corey, Gabriel, Michael, Bear, Flynn, Glencora, Per, Laura, Andrew, Alex, Karen, Jamie, Andrew, Jan, Jane, Kyle, Erador, Steve, Blade, Jim, Carlis, Peter, Jay, Josh, Raul, Nameriva, Roger, Thomas, Breton, Deda, Hansen, Nicholas, Alberto, Robin, and Anton, Mojarra Frita. This month, I'd like to welcome the newest members of the Taconspiracy, Enabler, Kyle, Anonymous, Kate, Ryan, and Sawyer, Panucho. With that said, we've been here before, so don't panic. Get organized and disrupt J20.
Fuck Donald Trump. Fuck Donald Trump. Yeah, nigga, fuck Donald Trump. Yeah, yeah, fuck Donald Trump.
Oh, we right. Second. Nah. We protest when we see the tour bus. Too scared to get out. That's why the door shut. Your politics are like a...